Everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park, and we're starting a webinar on Achilles injuries. So what is the Achilles tendon? Achilles tendon is named after the Greek hero Achilles, seen in the upper right, being dipped by his mom into the river Styx, and that conferred upon him invincibility in battle. of course, she had to hold him by the tendon, so that was the only part that was vulnerable to the eventual Trojan arrow that took his life. The reason we're doing this webinar is because over the last 8 years, I myself and other patients have experienced some complaints surrounding the Achilles. So let's go into that. As we look at the bottom of the human leg, we see that the triceps or three-headed muscle has the medial and the lateral head of the gastrocnemius. And if you peel that away deeper, there's a third muscle called the soleus, and they all join in this aponeurosis, which is the tendon that attaches to the Achilles. The purpose of the Achilles is also to store energy, as we see in this picture of Oscar Pretorius running. The reason why he gets such speed is because these prostheses bend and they store energy. Likewise, the Achilles tendon bends, and there is an elasticity inherent in it which allows you to get a return on your energy storage, allowing you to jump and run. What makes the Achilles prone to injury? Well, you know, it's bearing the entire weight of your body, especially if you're jumping and running. It's being stretched actively in the process. And so, like many organs, it's constantly being created and destroyed. Similarly, if you think of any organ, be it the skin, the largest organ, or the intestinal tract, which is constantly being auto-digested and then reconstituted, even the brain is being remodeled constantly, we always see a balance of what we would consider destruction and repair. A great example of this would be astronauts who are in space without gravity. They lose muscle, and more importantly, perhaps they lose bone because there's no gravity stressing, causing the need for inflammation, destruction, repair, and regrowth. The strength of the tendon comes from the bricks, which we would consider the tendon cells themselves. These are cells, after all, and created from stem cells like other cells, but also from the mortar, which is the extracellular matrix, or mainly consisting of collagen, also hyaluronic acid, which joins those bricks together. The keys, of course, are how much you're loading and how much you're destroying the tendon and how much time you give to recover. If that recovery time is inadequate in either quality or quantity, the inflammation leads to injury and even rupture. So again, what we see here as a motif is that there's injury to muscle, which allows for destruction, inflammation, and coming back stronger. In fact, that is the basis for why going to the gym and working out makes you stronger. There are a few studies of telomeres in tendons. One is by the eventual Nobel Prize winner Grider and her colleague Cal Harley, who is a friend and the collaborator with TA Sciences. And they chose initially to look at tendons. And what they found was that in these mammalian tendons, the telomeres indeed shorten with time. This was just a pilot study. And interestingly, when we look at the horse, which of course bear a tremendous weight on their analog, the equine superficial digital flexor tendon, this fascinating study came from just this year in the Scandinavian Journal of Science and Sports. And they thought, well, let's look at horses and see what happened in horses from 30 to 30 years. Do these tendons, do the cells and the telomeres reflected in those tendon cells age? And what they found was that they do not. So effectively, despite the horse's age, the Achilles tendon was able to run forever. Well, forever, but for a long time without noticeable aging, which is in keeping with what we would think about something that requires so much force, much like the heart, which has to pump so many times in a lifetime. There is no aging out of that particular organ, as we would see perhaps with the elasticity of the lens and presbyopia or reading glasses. The reason I wanted to talk about this is because this is not me, actually, but that is what I look like 3 to 5 times a week. I like to go to hot yoga. The heat, for some reason, coaxes your body into more pliability, I think. And so I'm able to touch my heels to the ground like that and stretch out the Achilles. Now, I've been taking telomerase activators or adaptogens for 8 years now. And over the last 8 years, I have noticed intermittently that there has been Achilles pain in my right tendon. Now, it's never ruptured, and it's never gotten to the point where I couldn't. I think one time it got to the point where I couldn't walk very well. But by and large, what we can say is that it hasn't gotten to the point where it's progressive. In other words, if this were a fundamental trait of telomerase activation, it would have gotten worse and irreversibly damaged. So another case came on early, I think in 2008, a fellow golfer who had taken Cipro mentioned that he had a full avulsion or a rupture of his tendon. And so I just filed it away. And as is the case with many of these webinars, I don't really try and make a big deal out of anything because stuff happens to everyone all the time. But when multiple people complain, then maybe it's time to do a webinar. Another acquaintance of mine had high-intensity running as part of her lifestyle, and she ended up rupturing both Achilles tendons while taking TA65. Dave, who is a runner and an attorney and also featured, I think, on either the Exercise or the Obesity podcast, mentioned to me that he had been taking a so-called generic form of TA65 and was very happy with the results in all aspects, but did mention and corroborate that occasionally Achilles discomfort is a factor. And then yesterday, as I spoke to Guy, our powerlifter friend, who at the age, I think, of 43 or 44, is, again, shaped like a Greek statue, and he can bench press and deadlift and all this. He also mentioned that occasionally the Achilles acts up. The association of quinolones, most notably Cipro is the one everyone knows, and Achilles injury has been established last week. After many years of case reports, Publixis and the group founded by Ralph Nader, of which he has not participated for many years, had finally succeeded in their pressure to get the FDA to issue a black box warning. It says, fluoroquinolones need stronger warnings about serious adverse effects, including tendinitis, rupture of tendons, prolongation of the QT interval, which is the time it takes for the heart cells to repolarize, peripheral neuropathy. So eventually things do get reported, but it's very difficult to get that association. Even if safety and efficacy studies in the initial FDA process might show an association, they rarely reach statistical significance and are not something that billions of dollars of investment would have you highlight. So unfortunately, the process of approving drugs is something that favors hiding side effects. The mechanism of this should be stated. There's one study out of the Journal of Applied Toxicology, 2014, which, although phenomenological in nature, did say that there was increased apoptosis in cartilage, and the increase of metalloproteinases, which are enzymes that break down cartilage, and decrease in inhibitors of metalloproteinases, which would all favor the melting or the breakdown of this collagen substance. That really doesn't tell you why it's happening. Again, you could have cell death, inflammation, and then activation of these enzymes. But what we do know is that there is an association. And so because these popular antibiotics are commonly used for travelers, diarrhea prevention, UTIs, community-acquired sinusitis, you should be careful. They have a specificity more in the later generation 3 and 4 for bacterial topoisomerase, which is thought to be the main mechanism. Topoisomerase is a winding enzyme required for DNA processing, but the Cipro and the older ones also acted on our mammalian cells, which likens it to a sort of general poison like chemotherapy. I'd like to return to my stem cell theory of aging described in Telomere Time Bombs, and in that book I described four different ways that telomerase activation could be working. First would just be long-term prevention of attrition of stem cells. Second would be increased stochastic activity, meaning the healthy cells are representing themselves better and more because they're copying at an advantage. Apoptosis seems to be triggered, and there's a fourth one which escapes me at this point. So how could this be contributing to what we're seeing? Well, there could be, on the one hand, inadequate apoptosis of dysfunctional stem cells. In other words, a loss of obsolescence. I did an interesting interview, which I'll post in the next week, in the next few days, with Liz Parrish, who just did gene therapy on herself with telomerase activation. And so the theoretical concern would be, well, let's say it's integrating into stem cells, but those stem cells are not allowed to die off in a normal fashion because they have, at least from the perspective of telomeres, increased longevity. This would be akin to leaves not falling from trees in the fall, but maybe winter or spring. What kind of downstream effects would that have in terms of overall cellular and organ dysfunction? Conversely, it could be accelerated apoptosis. What we could be looking at is telomerase activation could be causing cells to, or stem cells to go off faster. And then there are periods of time when you have these damaged stem cells, inflammation and clearing, and indeed the melting of the matrix that is associated to this activation of these cascades, collagenases, the metalloproteinases, could be leading to cells without mortar, mortarless bricks. Of course, quinolones, we already highlighted the problem. But I think that my intuition says it's probably just a normal load and repair imbalance because, again, over the last 8 years and probably over 1,000 patients, we don't see a progression. There's not an accumulation towards 100% asymptotically. In other words, if telomerase activation caused Achilles injury, then eventually everyone on it for 8 years would have accumulated Achilles tendon injury. So I'd like to just close with guidelines for adaptogenic use. First of all, always listen to your body. Sometimes one thing that came out in Liz Parrish's interview, the telomerase gene therapy CEO, was that she was sleeping at a precise time and couldn't wake up that easily. In her case, it was like 13 hours. And I highlight why that's the case in the circadian rhythm webinar. But a lot of interesting things happen when people first try TA or adaptogens is that your body doesn't need to be listened to. Your body tells you what to do, and that's a very interesting thing. So this is at the core of what we think adaptogens do. When we look at pharmacology, pharmacology blocks a pathway, and good luck with the downstream effects. They may be benign or even harmful. But an adaptogen will make Jack Spratt normalize. A person who eats too much will eat less. A person who eats too little will eat more. A person who sleeps too little will sleep longer. A person who sleeps too long less. Now, that is not consistent with blocking of pathways, but rather creating some kind of milieu where the cells are just happier and more functional. And so what we're doing is substituting just a better environment for the cells to optimize their behavior. Pain, of course, is never a good sign, especially in the case of these Achilles injuries. You want to heed that because pain is indicative of inflammation, and inflammation is indicative of a dangerous transition between stability and it's a rebuilding time. It's important to use the proper rest, meaning sleep, which of course is the ultimate regenerative anabolic phase, good nutrition, meditation, or at least happy thoughts, as described in my friend's book, The Fear Cure. A lot of dis-ease comes from our mental spiritual state, and these are all keys to optimization. The good news is that I've learned over the years that when people have a sudden pain, like I used to have a rotator cuff injury from yoga, and it was right here, and it would flare up. And usually in life, people who have these tendon injuries, they never go away. But I think part of the phenomenon of adaptogenic use is you can get, especially in the early week or two, first week, you can get inflammation, which to me is why I infer apoptotic mechanism. In other words, stem cells that are senescent and functional that have been there repeatedly damaged, they die off. And so there's that vulnerable time. And then if you can make it through, oftentimes within a couple of days, depending on your metabolism, that pain can be gone forever. And again, that's not anything but an empirical anecdotal report that I've seen in many people. You have to be a little more careful with poorly vascularized joints that encounter daily load-bearing, hip and especially meniscus in the knee, because I haven't seen as favorable results there because there's low vascularization. I did have a hanging medial meniscus in my right knee, which would prevent me from even bending it. And I was seriously considering doing arthroscopic surgery. But at this point, it's about 95%, and I don't have any pain. And whether that was related to telomerase activation, I don't know. But good news for me, no surgery. Because when you start cutting off those little hangnails or those bucket arms, they do not grow back. And it's a progression of loss, further degeneration and pain, and eventual knee replacement. For athletes such as Marty, who's a powerlifter guy, we need to have specific guidelines, and especially people who use HGH, testosterone, their muscles can hypertrophy at a rate that outpaces the tendon load-bearing capacity. And some feel that Eldrick Tiger Woods may have been on HGH ordered through Canada, and that may have contributed to his incredible musculature but tendon damage several years back. Given your body's ability to recover, you do need to give it that time, the downtime to do that. And so alternating regions, they call it leg day, I guess gym rats call it that. Don't do the whole body at once. Do the upper body and then do the lower body, and then they have, you know, several days to recover. One great thing about adaptogens that we hear pretty frequently is that the recovery time is decreased. In fact, that was highlighted by probably one of our first pre-proto podcasts with Larry, who said as a 70-something-year-old, his ability to recover his joints was increased. So it's a mixed blessing. You feel strong hormonally, cardiovascular strength, enthusiasm, but don't overdo it because you can cause damage, and then if you keep on overdoing it instead of repair, you get injury. That's really it. Not much to report. It's going to be a short webinar. I'd like to open it up now to questions. And again, as with many things, I learn more from you folks, so I'd love to hear what your thoughts are.
Dr. Park?
Hello, Guy. How are you, sir?
Good. How are you, Dr. Park?
I'm fine. Thank you for asking.
I just joined your seminar, your podcast. So I haven't heard what you've talked about earlier, but I actually had an Achilles injury from overuse.
Okay.
And it hurt, amazingly hurt. I thought I actually tore it, but I didn't, because I went to a podiatrist and said it was just an overuse Achilles injury. Surprisingly, she gave me a little heel lift. I was taking Recharge at the time. I took a little heel lift. A heel lift in my shoe,
yeah.
And within like overnight or the next day, the pain was completely gone.
Oh.
And I was like, I was still taking the Recharge about 3 or 4 a night, and the heel lift, and I was able to walk again. It didn't hurt. I put my weight on it. I was able to weight bearing exercise. It was almost like I completely recovered. I of course continued to take the Recharge. I continued to do exercises that wouldn't injure it more, but I felt completely healed and healthy.
Well, now that's a perfect illustration. So because of the biomechanics of raising the heel, there's less active stretching at the maximum load, and the Recharge was able to help you reproduce those stem cells in the matrix, and you got better faster. But a lot of people who are just gym rats, or they're, you know, they have to get their endorphin fix from running. What if they had not gone and made a mechanical alteration that might have led to injury? So you heated your body. That was well done.
Exactly. And I was very happy that it healed, because I wanted to continue training, which I was able to do. And while I do train 3 times a week, I take Recharge, and my recovery, even though I'm not a very good sleeper, my recovery is great. I'm able to do my heavy, intense lifting. I am a power lifter, a gold medal winning power lifter. I'm able to do my power lifting and heavy exercises all the time. Even my trainer is surprised that I don't have really off days or days where I'm not particularly strong. I continue to progress all the time.
And so what we see, yeah, that's a great point, is that you really get more bang for your buck, even in your 40s, from exercise. It's not, you don't go workout, injury, inflammation, you know, and then scarring. You go workout, inflammation, injury, and repair to a stronger state. So the problem with and working out as we get older is that the quality of stem cell repair and the efficiency of repair, you just don't get the return on investment that you do when you're...
Sorry for interrupting.
I notice
a lot of people in the gym who are older who have to take time off because of an injury or because of an overuse, a tiredness, a weakness, where they call in the morning and say, I didn't sleep well. I can't come in today. I'm not going to lift really well. Or, you know, they're not even lifting heavy, doing powerlifting. They just can't even work out that day because they're exhausted. They're tired. They haven't been able to recover. And this is even over a weekend where they haven't been able to recover. I can recover pretty much overnight, but I do still take that day of rest where I have like three sessions a week.
Yeah. I mean, that's amazing. I mean, I don't exercise in that way. But I know Marty, who is a big believer in Recharge. He can bench press almost twice his weight. I mean, he can do like 60
that's amazing.
Pull-ups at 71, but he's a phenomenon. But yeah, I mean, there's nothing to detract from your work ethic. If you're willing to put in the work, you get the results. But sadly, as we get older, because of the inefficiency of repair, the inefficiency of sleep, you know, that discipline can often lead to injury.